Okay, I'm very sorry, now I can start. I hope it will work. Just a moment. So today is the last lecture of this semester, and I would like to tell you some two theorems, I think. So let me recall some previously defined notation. So we consider as usual the algebra of symmetric functions. And I recall the notion of the scalar product, which makes this algebra pre-Hilbert space. And this scalar product is defined by proclaiming the Schur functions to be an orthonormal basis. So we have, and this is the Kronecker delta. And as I proved already some time ago, that the power sum functions also form a basis which is orthogonal but not orthonormal. And we have a following relation. Equal to Kronecker delta and times some coefficient. And I recall what is this coefficient. To write it, it is convenient to use the multiplicative form for partition rho. So I write it as follows. I recall this notation, which means that the coordinate, a given coordinate I, is repeated this number of times. This is the multiplicity of a given coordinate. Maybe it's written as follows. And what next? The next definition is follows to any function. We may associate the multiplication operator. So multiplication. Multiplication by F, which means that we have the regular representation of our algebra on itself. So F, we regard F is an operator on this space, which takes an arbitrary function and multiplies it by F. And because we have a scalar product, we may associate to it, to this multiplication operator, we may associate a joint operator. Operator, which is denoted as follows, or maybe I will also write it as follows, which means that we have a following defining relation. Given some function for any function g, we have multiplication by, so if you have two functions which you regard as two vectors of our space, then we have this relation. And here I regard this as an operator. It's an operator acting on our space. It is an exercise. to show the following. If we take as f a power sum function, then the adjoint operator, is equal to this one. Let me explain the notation. In this notation, I assume, so here it is assumed, that we identify our algebra with the ring of polynomials. In infinitely many variables. So what is the picture? We have this ring of polynomials, and any p sub k acts by multiplication on this space, and we have a scalar product, and the adjoint operator may be viewed as a partial derivative with respect to this representation, with this presentation. So this is easy to prove just using this fact. This fact and these and this expression for the norm, for the squared norm of any vector. Okay. And in particular, we can consider the so-called Heisenberg algebra. Heisenberg-Lie algebra, complexified, maybe it's better to say, complexified. So I tacitly assume that we replace the base field, not R, but C. But it's not very important. So or maybe I don't want to speak about Heisenberg-Lie algebra as usually said, but I could equally well to consider the so-called CCR algebra as follows. It is generated by the operators PK viewed as multiplication operators, and the adjoint operators and have infinitely many operators which act on our space, and they are subject to commutation relations. So we have these operators take the commutator, then we get Kronecker delta and multiplied by k, and the operators, these derivatives commute, pairwise commute, and these multiplication operators also pairwise commute. So these are up to this factor, which can be eliminated if necessary. They generate this algebra, which is called the algebra of canonical commutation relations. This is the abbreviation CCR. So we have this action of this algebra on the algebra of symmetric functions, or which is the same, the algebra of polynomials here. So this is an important notion. This is an important notion which you should keep in mind, because actually it is used in many, many situations Now, I would like to discuss some other topic. I would like to define a certain different representation, not of this algebra, but of a Lie algebra, a finite dimensional. This is an infinitely dimensional object. And now I would like to tell you something about a finite dimensional Lie algebra, and namely the simplest reductive Lie algebra, SL2. SL2 over C. So what is this algebra? It is the algebra of complex matrices of order 2 with trace equal to 0. So it is the span, the linear span of two matrices, two generators, which are denoted as E, F, and H. And they are represented by matrices. So E is such a matrix. F is this matrix. And finally, H is the diagonal and trace lace matrix, this one. And the commutation relations for these three elements are as follows. The bracket between H and E is equal to twice E. This bracket is minus and this bracket is equal to H. So these are basic relations which are frequently used for in the representation theory. So this algebra is a basic object of representation theory of Lie algebras and Lie groups. And what I want to construct now, I want to construct a linear representation of this algebra. I will write simply SL2 and omit C on this space. But it is more convenient for me to forget about symmetric functions and simply write this as a certain space V and distinguished basis, which is indexed by arbitrary Young diagrams. So one can identify these bases with Schur functions, but it's not necessary for me at this point. Simply a linear space with a basis and this index set. So I want to construct a representation. And this representation, it depends on two parameters, which already appeared, ZZ prime will be arbitrary complex numbers. Now I want to write explicitly the formula. So the action of these generators is defined as follows. So for E, I will identify E as an element of a Lie algebra with a corresponding operator just for simplicity. So I write formula. I would like to introduce some notation which I will use. So I will suppose that I will manipulate with a quadruple of Young diagrams. So I assume that I have two Young diagram lambda and kappa on some level n, and next some diagram mu of the level n plus one, and some smaller diagram mu, which is on the level n minus one. This is level n plus one, and these edges just mean that this diagram differs from this one by adding a box, likewise for this one, and likewise for this one. So the differences, all these differences are by a single box. So this is the picture which I propose to keep in mind. So I repeat, there are two complex parameters, and now I proceed to writing down the action of my elements. It's as follows. So the formula for E looks as follows. We have a sum of all nu, of all possible nu, which are above lambda. And so I write here, suppose that nu is obtained from lambda by adding some box. Some box. Okay. This is the content of this box. And this is as follows. So this is finite sum. Next, the action of F is the minus sign here, and the sum is over all mu, which is below lambda. So mu is obtained from lambda by deleting some box. Maybe it's not important here because I don't need the box. So I'm sorry, I will simply write this as follows. So mu is below lambda, and that's all. And finally, I need a formula for H. And the operator H is diagonal in this basis. And the action is as follows: Z prime plus twice the number of boxes. This one. So these are my formulas. And these are the so-called Kerr operators. Kerr operators. Sometimes they are written a bit differently, but this is up to some, one can say, gauge transformation. So I will use this. This terminology, care of operators, and the claim. So the claim is this theorem. So this is a representation. Representation of our Lie algebra on this space. So the claim just means that these operators defined by this formula satisfy the commutation relations for the Lie algebra. How to prove? So we need to prove three commutation relations. I remark that these two relations are trivial. These are trivial And it's not important that you have for these two relations, the exact form of this coefficient is not important. What is really important is this coefficient. This is not, it's not important also. And this is also trivial because this coefficient is responsible for adding some scalar operator. And after taking commutator, it does not matter if you add some scalar operator. So what is really important is this term and this coefficient two is exactly responsible for this coefficient. So if you look a little bit, you will see that for this commutation relations, it's okay, it's trivial, it's pretty trivial. But this is not trivial, this last relation is not trivial, and I proceed to a proof. I would like also to indicate some reference is the paper by Okunkov. I will give you the reference to the archive, so it's easy. So, write more precisely. This is the old archive, so you should to add this math in order to get and this in this paper by Okunkov one can read some story related with so-called Z measures and Kerhoff operators. It's not maybe too easy to read, but it's very deep paper. I like it very much. But now I return to the proof. Proof of the relation. So what we have to do. Just to look at what happens, so we have to take a commutator is this one. We have to apply it to this and to prove that it's equal to the action of H, and we know what it is by definition. This is what we have to prove. How to do this? So let's write in detail what we have to do. And I claim that the left-hand side is the following expression. It is the difference of two sums. One sum is as follows. We have to sum over kappa and nu, and I recall the picture. You have to see that here, that this picture, kappa is on the same level, and it is obtained in this way. Okay, we move up and move down. So this is written as follows. So I assume that we have kappa and nu is obtained. Nu is obtained from lambda by adding some box. I will denote it as box number with index one because I will need some other set of boxes numbered by index two. So we have Z plus. So given this nu, I write it as follows. So I recall that this notation is maybe it's not rigorous. It just means that we have this picture. So we have with kappa, we have this picture. And nu kappa. This is one sum and minus another sum, and here we have kappa and mu. And so we have picture is as follows. You have lambda, you have some mu below, which is can be obtained by removing a box, and then kappa. And this the box which corresponds to this picture, to this edge in the Young graph. This I denote it by box number 2, which is kappa minus mu. So this is, I assume that kappa and mu here are related to each other by this, in this way. And here I have Z plus. Z prime. So what we have, I repeat, we have lambda, which is here, and we have a sum over some kappa, but the coefficient, it depends, given kappa, the coefficient depends of this nu. Auxiliary.
There is also prime in the second bracket.
Sorry?
There is also, should be prime in the second bracket, in the first summand.
Ah, yes, I see here, okay. And these two expressions just come from this picture. And I would like only to indicate that this sum comes from this term, not this one. And there is no minus sign because F, the minus sign is canceled with this minus sign. So this sum comes from this part. And the second sum comes from this term. Okay. So this is because here we first go up and then we go down. This is reflected in this picture. While here we first go down and then up. So this term corresponds to this. And I claim the first claim that the result is zero unless kappa is equal to lambda. It's not completely obvious, and this requires some argument, maybe a little bit. We have to think a little bit. So what is the picture here?
It seems like one of the problems of homework, like 3 or 4 weeks ago.
Yes. It's related. It's indeed related. You are right. You are right. So the idea is that the add some box and remove some box. And so the claim why this happens is just because the boxes which in this situation which appear here are exactly the same. These boxes and these boxes are precisely this one. The boxes which can be added to our lambda. This is exactly in the case when kappa is distinct from lambda. So the result is zero. And it's well because we need to get some multiple of the initial vector. So now we examine the case. So examine the case kappa is equal to lambda. And indeed, as you will see, the result will be given by some problem, some exercise, which I gave you some time ago. Namely, what we get? In this case, the result is as follows. The left-hand side is as follows. It is the sum of a nu, such that nu is lambda plus some box, z plus z prime . So I write, maybe it's better to write the coefficient. Coefficient of on left hand side. So it's equal to this one minus the sum of a mu such that mu is obtained from lambda by removing some box z plus . So this is the result that we want. And now what happens? Let's use the care of interlacing coordinates. For lambda. So I recall. So x is y is and they interlace and you have this picture. Picture is so these are x1 and so on. And what we have now, we have that these contents are precisely the x coordinates And these contents are y coordinates. So this can be written as follows. Have a sum over I from 1 prime minus j from 1 And what is this? F z prime plus z plus z prime x I plus x I squared minus a similar expression. So, and what is the result? If you take this sum and subtract this one, we get 1, because we have r summons and r minus 1. And we also know that the sum of the x's is equal to the sum of the y's. So we get, so the result is as follows. This is zz prime, which comes from these terms. The contribution of this is 0. And we have the sum of a minus and using the fact that the sum of the x's equals the sum of the y's, and if you look at the problem, what one of the problem of the problems, and we finally can conclude that this is exactly what we want. Plus twice the area of the Young diagram, which is this one. So this is the end of the proof, which shows that we indeed get some representation. And in the paper by Okunkov, if you want, you can read some applications of this result. Now I would like to change the topic and tell you finally one more story. It's related to some paper by Richard Stanley. And he made the maybe somebody else, some mathematician, I'm sorry, I forgot his name. And Stanley wrote a paper about the following topic. Following topic is as follows. So this can be, topic can be called Blancherelle average. Here, there is also some paper of mine. If you wish, we can look at it, about the story and about some generalization. I will tell you only this, some elementary part, but there are more results and some generalization of what I will show you. But now, what is the Planckian average? So let's take the Young diagrams of a fixed level n, and I recall the definition of the Planckian probability measures. This set. It's defined as follows. The weight it assigns to a given Young diagram is given to the squared dimension divided by n factorial. And it is one of the nice identities that these expressions indeed sum to one as lambda ranges over this set. And so assume that f is some function. This is only the definition, some function. At this moment, arbitrary. For the definition, it's an arbitrary function on the Young, on the set of Young diagrams. And its average of level n is defined as the sum over lambdas, the values, we take the values and multiply with this weight. So this is a weighted sum. One can say that, also one could say that given these measures, we get a probability space, a finite probability space. Finite set with a probability measure, given a function on it, we can regard it as a random variable. And then what I wrote here is its expectation, weighted sum, but these are simply some words. It's not necessary to understand. So this is just some average with respect to this measure. And now the claim. The claim is as follows. This is the initial claim, which is mentioned by Stanley. In fact, he proved something more, but let me restrict to the following claim. So assume that phi is a symmetric function. So phi is some function, symmetric function in infinitely many variables, as usual. And given a Young diagram, let's take its boxes. And let C1, C2, and Cn, and here, so be their contents. So now I want to define a function, some functions f with index phi, its value at lambda is by definition equal to the following. We take this symmetric function and substitute as variables the contents. Here, next zeros as usual. So we get some function. So I repeat, we fix an arbitrary symmetric function phi. And it gives rise to some functionals, to some function on the set of Young diagrams. And the claim is as follows. So the claim is that if you take the average of this function of level n, the result is a polynomial in n. Its dependence on the index n is polynomial. So this is a claim. And I want to show you that the result is very simple, actually, provided we already know some material related to this story. And we, in fact, we know some. So what we know? I recall that we know the concept of algebra A. Algebra of regular functions. Regular functions on this set. And we know that this algebra can be defined in various ways. So for instance, you have we know the algebra of shifted symmetric functions, and it is actually isomorphic to our algebra. Namely, given a shifted symmetric functions, we assign to it the function in lambda by taking the row lengths as arguments. These are arguments which are substituted here. And we also know that the same algebra can also be obtained as symmetric functions, as polynomials maybe. Polynomials, this is also the same as polynomials in power sums. Power sums, and again in the contents. The contents. So we can take the contents, even the Young diagrams. We can take the parameter k can be 1, 2, and so on. And the resulting function is again in our algebra. And what we get here? The first observation is that this function belongs to the algebra generated by these functions, because symmetric functions are generated by the power sums. So actually what we get is the following. We can reformulate the theorem equivalent formulation. Now is full. So I again write f. If f is a regular function, an element of our algebra A, then the Poincaré averages are polynomials. Polynomial in N. But now it's convenient to use this isomorphism to forget about this picture and use this isomorphism. And we know that we have some analogs of Schur functions. You have the shifted Schur functions. Shifted Schur functions. This is a basis in the algebra of shifted symmetric functions. And I recall the definition. The definition is follows. First, we define shifted Schur polynomials, so object infinitely many variables. They obtained by taking the usual definition of the Schur polynomials, and where we replace the, make some shifts of variables and replace the powers, the ordinary powers by falling factorial powers, we get some polynomials, which are symmetric and shifted variables, and they are stable. And this enables us to define object in infinitely many variables, which are elements of this algebra. So it's enough to prove our result for the shifted Schur functions. So our functions now take the form shifted Schur function evaluated at lambda. But now I recall we have a nice result. So I assume that mu has m boxes and lambda has n boxes. And we know, I proved that one of the previous result is that we have this formula. This is the following factorial power, some coefficient times the this, and divided by the dimension. And I recall that the numerator is the number of paths in the Young graph, which connect the smaller diagram to the bigger diagram, to the larger diagram, or zero if there is no paths. So it's equal to zero if mu is not contained in lambda. And we know that we have this relation. But now we can rewrite what we need to study. So we can rewrite this as follows. So by the very definition, I recall this is the sum of lambda here, and we have lambda but now look at this expression. Look at this expression, and we see that this can be written as follows. First of all, we get this coefficient. Next, there is a partial cancellation because this factor is cancelled, partially cancelled with this dimension. And so we get here divided by n factorial. And okay. Now we have to work with this expression. How to do this? By the very definition, not my definition, I have to invoke now the Pieri rule. The Pieri rule, which is related to the Young graph. We know that the edges are obtained from, I'm sorry, I have some question. It is not six, but five. Thank you. And I wrote six. Maybe I was mistaken. I'm sorry, probably I was mistaken. Thank you. Probably so, thank you. So I can resume. So I have to analyze this expression. And what I need to show you. So let's examine these and these factors. I claim that with relative dimension can be written as follows. So this is the scalar product. And this one, which is a particular case of the previous one when mu is the empty diagram. So this is simply so why? So this is because the combination of facts that the edges are related to multiplication by P sub one. And next we use the fact that the coefficient, we need a coefficient of this, the coefficient of S lambda, and this coefficient is obtained by taking the scalar product because the Schur functions form an orthonormal basis. So we get these two expressions. And now I can rewrite again. I can rewrite this using these formulas. And I get the following expression. Factorial. This one. And again, I use the fact that the Schur functions form an orthonormal basis. And this implies, but this is the same as this is the same as the scalar product. The scalar product this one. This is because these functions form an orthonormal basis. And what next? So we are left with this expression. And I use now the fact that I mentioned in the very beginning. This is the operator of multiplication, sorry. The operator of multiplication. And we can to move it on the right, to move this operator on the right and take in the conjugate. And doing so, we get the following. This is equal to sorry, forgot something, maybe. Just a moment. Okay. So I use the fact that this is exactly this one. So I have to take and this gives me, and this gives me the term so on and up to mu and okay. So this is some quantity which does not depend on M, does not depend on N. So this does not depend on N. It depends only on mu. And what is here? So what we, so no, so sorry, this is, I'm sorry, this is stupid. This is absolutely stupid. This is n minus one, n minus m plus one, okay? So what we get this quantity, and this is this binomial coefficient times this one. And the result is as follows. So we get some factor which does not depend on n, and times the binomial coefficient, which is a polynomial in n of degree m. So we get in this way the desired claim about the polynomial form of this function, of this average. And because it holds for a basis, it holds always for any element. So this is the proof. So this is
the problem. There should be just m plus one if we subtract from n, n minus m and plus one.
Sorry, do you think this is incorrect? Something?
When we differentiate p1 in degree n, we get n, n minus one, etc. N minus n minus m plus one.
Ah, yes. Yes. Again, yes, I see. So what we get? Sorry, is something wrong? No. Okay. So I'm sorry, this one, okay? Thank you, indeed. Okay, so this is the end. Okay, so what I would like to add in the end, that I tried to show you some facts, some elementary facts about symmetric functions and Schur functions and related facts. I did not manage to tell you about more complicated more complicated functions, Jack functions, Jack symmetric functions, or MacDonald symmetric functions. This is another story, technically more complicated. But finally, I would like to explain why I paid so much attention to the care of coordinates. This is because they have applications, and not only so. One of the reasons is that they give, in some situation, they give a tool of working with a Jack polynomial situation. And it turns out that there is some simple modification of the care of coordinates, which is adapted to the Jack symmetric functions. But what is missing in this story, and this is a problem, really a problem, is that there is no such interpretation on the level of MacDonald's symmetric functions. This is why MacDonald's symmetric functions from this perspective, which is related to the Z measures, this, all these stories about these formulas, this kind of formulas. All these arguments can be extended to the context of Jack symmetric functions, but not MacDonald symmetric functions. What happens here in the MacDonald situation is unclear. So, okay, I would like to stop at this moment. So this is the, I repeat, this is the last lecture. And I will not give you more exercises, and the scores I will give you, no examination, but I will, the scores will be computed according to the homework. So, okay, so I would like to stop here. Are any questions? Do you have any questions, maybe?
Why did you get a polynomial in N? Because it seems like...